A very good morning to all of you. It's really a pleasure to be here, and I thank the organizers of APPI for giving me this opportunity. In fact, I feel one of them because I've been coming here every year for the past 5 years, and this is my fifth year. I would like to thank SysMex for giving me this opportunity and sharing some of the experiences that we have had over the past 1.5 years on digital hematology. Over the next 25 minutes, we'll just see why digital. Why are we trying to go digital? Then a quick slide on difference between digital radiology. I think there's a lot of success story in digital radiology. Why digital pathology did not actually take off the way digital radiology went. And then we have been practicing digital pathology, whole slide imaging, for quite some time now, nearly 4 years. And we have looked at digital hematology only in the recent 1.5 years. And then finally, share some cases. The purpose of sharing the cases is not really to challenge you, but it's just to let you know that in the course of our workflow in hematology, how it has got integrated. And finally, I would summarize. So why digital? I think it's part of an ongoing industrial revolution. If I have to get you into the history for a while, the first industrial revolution happened between the 18th and the 19th century, and typically it was to do with the iron, textile, and steam technology. And then the second industrial revolution happened sometime between 1870 and 1914, where the analog machines, the oil and electricity, came in. And subsequently, 1980 till now, and it's still going on, is the digital revolution. Now, while it started in 1980s, we are only experiencing all of this right now. And incidentally, there's a fourth industrial revolution, and I was not aware of this. I got to know of this only when I was preparing for this talk. And the fourth industrial revolution started in 2006, because the first phrase of the fourth industrial revolution was coined by the World Economic Forum in 2016, as recent as 2016. So we are part of the industrial revolution that is happening. So when you look at analog, which was in the second industrial revolution, we should naturally have gone into the digital revolution, which was the third industrial revolution. And then the fourth, that's the way we would need to go. But somehow I feel, as pathologists, we are trying to take a leapfrog right from analog to artificial intelligence. So that may happen to many of us who would not get into the digital revolution, go straight into the artificial intelligence and the robotics. So why digital pathology? I think it appears to be a step in the evolution of pathology practice. It's important for you to understand I'm talking about pathology practice. I'm not talking about pathology as a science. Pathology as a science is amazing, and that would not change if you change the way pathology is practiced. So I'm only talking about a step in the evolution of pathology practice, particularly surgical pathology, now hematology, and clinical pathology. So if we continue to do what we have always done, we will always get what we have always gotten. So there is no point in doing the same thing over and over again and expecting something very different, and I think that's insanity. So when we look at digital pathology, we are looking at the slide, converting it in, meaning typically seeing it under the microscope, and that's conventional pathology. But now we convert that into a digital image through an instrument, and then use that image to view on a screen. So there is a fundamental way in which the image is viewed as compared to the conventional microscopy. A quick difference between digital radiology and digital pathology. I think for radiology, it was a very natural extension. They moved from films to images. There's nothing drastic about it. And it eliminates the need to handle chemicals. I think that was a very important decision making for digital radiology. And the technology itself was a cost replacement. It was not an added cost. While in digital pathology, you still have the slide. You still need to go through the slide processing, prepare the slide, because that's the basis on which the digital image gets done. So in digital radiology, it resulted in cost reduction, but in digital pathology, we cannot claim the cost reduction, but the dynamics of economics are different in digital pathology. It's also the fact that the pathologist's mindset and comfort level with digital images is coming, and I'm happy to say that over the past 15 years, 2003, I organized the first telepathology CME in Bangalore, and it was a revelation because I thought by 2008, we would all be looking into the screens and not under the microscope. But it so happens, even today, we are still with the microscope. So it has a lot to do with the mindset, but fortunately, the younger generation that are coming out are so comfortable with the digital revolution that they adopt to this very quickly. So the fundamental difference is like this, between an e-book and a print book. Just to understand, how many in the audience still use hardbound books? Please raise your hands. How many use e-books? Please raise your hands. Wow, 50%. That's nice. The thing is, in digital pathology, you cannot go away from the physical nature of the slide. That's still going to be there. Whereas in e-books, you don't need to have the physical book, but you can just have the e-book. So when you look at the difference between digital slide and the conventional slide, there's a whole lot of differences. Storage is one big aspect. I've known of many institutes and labs who are trying to invest in digital pathology only to take care of their storage problems. And I don't see that as a big advantage. See, the digital pathology will work amazingly well and sustainable only if it is used for primary reporting. If the equipment, a capital intensive equipment, is going to be used for anything other than primary reporting, it's, in my view, it's not going to be sustainable. If you use it for education, second consult, storage, none of these are actually going to make it sustainable. The moment you start using it for primary reporting, that's when it's going to be extremely sustainable and useful. All of us are very emotionally attached to the microscope. I have had personal discussions and all of them say, I don't get that fine adjustment on the monitor of the digital slide. I don't see where that comes from, because I've had digital slides being viewed and I don't see that as a big challenge in trying to come to a reasonable diagnosis. So what's the difference between digital pathology or whole slide imaging and digital hematology? In digital pathology, whole slide imaging is you're actually replacing the glass slide, whatever tissue is on the glass slide, into a digital image. You're not really processing that image to do something other than just viewing it. It's a complex process, and there's no digital manipulation. Whereas in hematology, it's different. It's a smear, digitized, but then there is post-processing. The images are then converted to sensible data to give you additional information. So what I'm going to do is, we have implemented and used digital morphology in hematology for some time now, and the resource that we use is a DI-60 analyzer, inside which is CellaVision. CellaVision is the company that actually took the imaging in hematology to the next level, and this is inside a box called DI-60. And that's the image. And that's my colleague, Dr. Kavya, looking at the screen to look at the images rather than under the microscope. She has the microscope next to her though. Any challenges with the digital image, the slide is available and it gets onto the microscope. From now on, I'll be putting out only images. And these images are essentially out of the DI-60. Anything on this image? So, yeah. So you see, I don't know how many of you can see this word spherocytes here, and it has given 23%. So all you do is click on that, and it shows up all the spherocytes. And you have a percentage of spherocytes. But having started to use this, I realized that as we see this, you see there are many spherocytes that are still not counted. But this is where the learning also happens. This is where the maturation of the software also happens. So then there was another microsites. So you click on microsites, you get all the images of the microsites. May not be perfect, but at least you get a sense of what's happening. And on this case, we did a eosin 5 maleimide on the flow cytometry, and it clearly showed a 39% reduction in MFI, which is considered diagnostic because any decrease beyond 21% is considered a hereditary spherocytosis. So osmotic fragility was increased and the decrease in MFI was extreme. This is another view that you can get. All the cells are laid down in rows for you to see how these cells are. This is another case in which there were spherocytes again. It was just the way it is expressed is at the comfort level of the viewer. Anything on this slide? Target cells. You see, you don't need digital hematology. And you see, target cells are highlighted. I just click on that, and you get all the target cells. And you get the percentage of target cells that you are looking at. This will, of course, improve over time, because you might see target cells in the background that are not shown up. So you might have missed some target cells. But nevertheless, what is important is to know that we are in the right direction. And that had a A2 of 5.4. Sickle, I click on that and it shows all the sickles. And it says 14% sickles. So you kind of have a quick way of letting yourself know, and 83% HBS. So we earlier did not have remote user access. We had to go to the machine, to the PC next to the machine to see the cells there. But over time, we got remote user access and we are able to see it in different workstations. So all the pathologists can view it in different. So this is a screenshot. This is not many. I took a picture of the screen. And just to let you know that each of these cells can be double-clicked and then you'll get a bigger view of the same. Anything? All straightforward. Nothing challenging. Unidentified cells, blasts 31, 34%. So you see something there in the meaning. Let me tell you one thing. You don't need digital pathology, digital hematology to see this. You can see it in the microscope. All I'm trying to see is the way it gets integrated into our workflow without the microscope. And then it becomes easy for us to integrate this into our LIS because we take these images and store it in our LIS. At any point in time when we retrieve that number, that particular patient records, we have all of them. I think, have you started to get to see these cells? Abnormally dark lymphocytes. I think we are getting into that season now, and all of us are prepared for platelet counts. So my colleague, Dr. Vikas, did a study and he showed that ADLs in a 100 cell differential has a good negative predictive value. And if he uses one cell as a cutoff, it's very sensitive but very low specificity. But if he uses a 5-cell count, then its specificity is good but sensitivity goes down. And these are the cells that start showing up on the CellaVision. On the digital hematology. So these images become easy as opposed to these. What do you think these are? Yeah, reactive lymphocyte. This was a case of EBV positive infectious mononucleosis, but that for a moment I would have thought it's a blast, but then the flowing cytoplasm I wouldn't really. This I put basically to let you know that staining has everything to do with it. On the left-hand side, it's the same case. It's the same dark blue lymphocyte. But on the left-hand side is right GIMSA. On the right-hand side is Leishman. They're completely different. They look different. And we need to be aware of this before we start interpreting these things. A 23-year-old lady, routine health check. I don't see anything out of the way in this. Elliptocytosis. And it's coming up to 46%. I'll show it. So I was trying to understand, do we have a document that tells us what is the significance? What are the numbers that make a particular cell significant or not? And this is the article which recommends standardization of nomenclature and grading of peripheral blood cell morphology features, and it gives for each of them, for example, here we are talking of elliptocytes, moderate is 5 to 20 and many is more than 20, and in this case it was 46%. So essentially it's not that it's difficult to look at elliptocytes under the microscope, it's just that it's getting integrated, you are getting a quantification of the same cell that you see under the microscope. How many of you get to see cells after GCSF administration? I'm sure many of you get to see it. So basically what happens is when the GCSF is given, there's plenty of these granulocytes coming out and their side scatter increases. And that's because of the kind of granulation that you see in these cells. All of this is visible under the microscope. So it's important for you to understand that what I'm trying to tell you is I'm not changing the science of pathology. It's only the change in the way pathology is practiced. 70-year-old lady, drug history of dapsone, anemia for evaluation. Hemoglobin of 7.9. Yeah. So what this showed up is schistocytes of 13.7%. And the moment you click on schistocytes, all the schistocytes, not necessarily all, some of them, you see some of them may still be, may not show up. So you get a percentage of schistocytes. Now, this becomes relevant in emergency as well. This is a critical result to be reported. And you get a value that you can use. It may be absolute or it could be just an approximate number. Anything? Yeah. Nice platelets around the granulocytes. Platelet satellitism. Again, this would have been seen under the microscope. So that is from the paper, and this is from the image that we took from our slide. That's my colleague, Dr. Preeti, seeing this cells, and my colleague, Dr. Pradeep. They are the ones who contributed to this. 9.2 hemoglobin. Target cells. And strangely, it says sickle cell 1.1%. Hemoglobin S of 74%. 76-year-old, anemia and thrombocytopenia, CBC. Platelets, not so good. Anything on the scatter? I'm a bit concerned when the scatter becomes hazy. And what would you think when the scatter becomes hazy when there's no separation of cells? 76-year-old. Do the cells look good? Dysplastic? We call this myelodysplastic syndrome, and it's gone for cytogenetics. The same case incidentally had stomatocytes, and my colleague Dr. Pradeep tells me that he gets to see stomatocytes in MDS. It's not that every case of MDS has stomatocytes or every case of stomatocytosis is MDS. It's just that he's seen a kind of a relationship, and stomatocytes are 14% in this case. And there's this cell in that same screen that doesn't look good. So these were the cells that were on that smear. 14-year-old boy, 12 grams. Incidentally here, we kind of put it in the rows. And I was surprised to see 7 sickle cells. And I'm not really convinced that these are sickle cells. And in fact, I told my colleague, they don't appear to be sickle cells. Because in a sickle, you don't see a central pallor. You need to see you need to see homogeneous hemoglobinization. But it turned out to be a sickle. So I would not have asked for a electrophoresis, but my colleague insisted because he thought it was sickle. So what I'm trying to tell you is, the DI60, the digital hematology, is not the end. It's a means to the end. It's a tool. It's a tool like the microscope, where you use it as a resource. And that's the hardware. And that's the one that is visible. Because any resource you take, whether it's man, method, material, money, all of these are visible. But just because you have these in hand doesn't mean it's going to work on its own. You need to have a process. And you need to understand what your current workflow is, how would you want to use this tool in your workflow. So we built a workflow to ensure that we have the CellaVision built into the workflow. So we have samples reaching the hemat lab. They get sorted to the various testing modalities. Then there is a review criteria. And if it passes, it gets into the LIS and gets reported. If no, it gets held. A cell counter smear stain gets done and automatically gets into the CellaVision DI60, and the technology screens. This is where I see a lot of competence enhancement, because when the technologist sees it under the microscope, he or she believes a monocyte is a lymphocyte or an atypical lymphocyte and gets away with it. But there's no clarification because there's so much of work to be done and nobody wants to really look into the microscope again. And then the pathologist screens, and if there is a concurrence, it gets reported. If not, then it goes under the microscope. It's important to understand that we have the microscope with us. It'll be quite some time before we detach ourselves from the microscope. So that process has to be there, but that's invisible. You see, the process is invisible. Your resources are visible, the process is invisible. But most importantly, both the resource and the process will work if your priorities are right. And I believe for us, the digital morphology, hematology, has added value to patient care. And I think that is invaluable for us. So when we look at the overall picture, what is that there is value to community health. And if we are all sitting here and discussing with each other, it is only for one reason, that we have to enhance our community health. So digital morphology in hematology is fully integrated into the workflow for us. We have multi-user remote access, very important. The highlights include excellent WBC and RBC imaging. Platelets are still a while away. We have found advantage in quantifying the RBC abnormalities that have happened, and the reporting software workflow is really integrating or synergizing with our LIS. We have a body fluid mode. I did not bring it in. All of these are the ones who actually contributed to the slides. I'm standing here and making the presentation. Thank you very much. If there are any questions, I would be happy to. Yeah, almost all the slides are automated staining. Yes. Yeah, I was in two minds whether to show the parasites here or in the workshop. So I thought I'll keep it for the workshop tomorrow.
Would you like to repeat that question once so that everybody gets to know?
Does it show parasites also?
Yeah, it shows parasites, but it's not a great system for parasites because it's still in the learning mode. But we have seen parasites, and I've kept it for the workshop tomorrow.
Thank you.
We have time for a couple of more questions. I'm going to take this and come back to you then, sir.
Sir, is there any relevance to report the percentage of schistocytes? There was some clinician who wanted to know what is the percentage of schistocytes.
Absolutely. Now, the thing about schistocytes is, if you see schistocytes, don't report. But if you see schistocytes in a clinical context, you have to give the percentage because then it becomes critical alert. People use different cutoffs. I've heard a cutoff of 0.5%, and it's really intense. So you need to be sure that you're able to pick up all of those schistocytes and use that percentage. So particularly in a hospital lab setup, I see this of great value. Dr. Riedel from one of the countries in Europe has used this tremendously for emergency room reporting situation, where MAHA, microangiopathic hemolytic anemia, is one of the emergencies.
Hello?
Yes.
I am Dr. Patwardhan.
Yes, please.
And I am a bit fascinated with smartphone photomicrography. Thank you very much for relieving digital technophobia from us. And I find there is a lot of scope for smartphone photomicrography in this, especially it is affordable and we can do a lot of in this. It is possible that artificial intelligence can be incorporated in this. Probably bigger companies may see it. But affordability is a problem in India, and we have done a lot of things about this in Thane group. We have discussed over 500 cases, and this was published in Digital Pathology Association website. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. That's amazing to hear, because it's good to use readily available technology to look at the routine work that we do. I'm glad to hear that.